द प्रैक्टिस ऑफ संलेखन। इन द इंडियन वे ऑफ लाइफ वी से यू हैव थ्री चॉइसेस फॉर लिविंग। यू कैन लिव एज अ भोगी और अ रोगी और अ योगी, बट यू कैन डाई ओनली एज अ योगी और अ रोगी। अ भोगी इज अ वन हु इज लॉस्ट इन मेटेरियल और सेंसुअल प्लेजर। अ रोगी इज अ वन हुज लाइफ इज कंटेन्ड बाय द डिजीज ही इज सफरिंग फ्रॉम। अ योगी इज समवन हु हैज अचीव्ड यूनियन और हार्मनी विद द एग्जिस्टेंस। यू कैन लिव इन एनी ऑफ द थ्री स्टेट्स, बट फॉर डाइंग देयर आर ओनली टू चॉइसेस। यू कैन ईदर डाई एज अ रोगी और एज अ योगी। देर इज नो चॉइस ऑफ डाइंग एज अ भोगी। At one time, in this culture, a large number of people chose to die as a yogis. But today, they are all choosing to die as rogis. There is a whole industry that has come up for this. Maybe they feel that they have to support it. Currently, in the US, a disproportionately large number of healthcare interventions are being done in the last 30 days of human life. Why do you need so much intervention at that stage? This effort is not for well-being, as this results mostly in torturing people to the extreme, knowing fully well that they anyway have to die soon. So before those last 30 days, let us say 6 months prior to that, you decide to taper down your life and leave. This is the most sensible way to conduct your mortal nature. Why some people, even those who are not on the spiritual path, want to leave their body consciously is because they do not want to die with tubes hanging out of their body. They want to slowly run it down and leave gracefully, rather than go through all kinds of torture. What happens in the hospital is worse than hell. That is a fact. If you do not know this, please make a trip and spend a few days in all the general wards in government hospitals in India. You will see that this is one place you do not want to end up in. This is the reason why a lot of healthcare professionals in the US sign the advance Do Not Resuscitate directive. They see the endless struggle that people go through with tubes and needles sticking in them, just keeping the body alive and prolonging suffering. They may do this for their patients, but they do not want it to happen to them when their own time comes. In the past, people handled it differently in this culture. Let us say you did not know any yoga and you were over 80 years of age and were still okay. You would probably last another 10 to 15 years at the most. But knowing that the body is becoming infirm, let us say you took a call. This is the time for me to run it down consciously. Anyway, you were going to run it down. You just decided to run it down consciously. So from 2 meals a day, you brought it down to 1 meal for a few years. Then from 1 meal, you make it a half meal and so on. This can greatly enhance one's lifespan or bring it down, depending upon one's karmic and energy situations. But it will not definitely ensure freedom from prolonged suffering. In the past, when people went to vanaprastha ashrama, they usually went from fruit to fresh leaf to dry leaf, and dry leaf to just water, and then they stopped the water too. After that, in 3 to 5 days, they exited because they did not want to die as a rogi. Is this suicide? Definitely not. Suicide happens out of frustration, out of anger, out of fear, or out of an inability to bear suffering. This is neither suicide nor euthanasia. This is about being so aware that you know when life has completed its cycle and you walk out of it. This is about developing sufficient awareness to separate yourself from the physicality that you have gathered. In that level of awareness, one can live. If you do not attain such a level of awareness, then the least you should do is make the last moment very graceful, pleasant, joyful, and blissful for yourself. This can be done if you manage certain things beforehand. If none of this is possible, then at least one can take the decision not to choose excessive medical intervention. This will be good for you and good for the planet. Modern societies are getting more and more obsessed with extending the human lifespan at any cost. You must understand that not everyone is geared to live for 100 to 105 years. If you want to do that, you must calibrate your life in so many ways. Unfortunately, for most of these millennial immortality seekers, all they have known in their life is the pleasures of the body, the joys and pains of psychological drama, and the intoxication of power in the world they live in. All of this being physical, they have not looked beyond that dimension at all. Today, with advanced medical interventions, hormones or supplements or stem cells or whatever, they are only managing to somehow keep the body alive. When people have run out of their software, but their hardware is still on, they will become like empty cells. There are too many such empty cells like that in Western societies now. Some people who work with such people were telling me that there are these 85 or 90-year-old men and women who have lost all their memory, but they remember one thing from their adolescence time, that they must attract the opposite sex. They have forgotten everything else, but this one thing has remained due to the chemical nature of that aspect of life that etches itself in one's system. They can barely walk, they are in wheelchairs and all that, but whoever comes, visitor, worker, anyone, if they are of the opposite sex, they want to grab them. Every day, in an attempt to appear attractive, they wear all kinds of lipsticks and smudge themselves with all kinds of makeup, or cut themselves by trying a clean shave. Whosoever they see, they try to grab them. You see how pathetic it is. But this kind of thing is celebrated in today's society. If you are 90 and still romancing someone, that is considered a great thing. It is not considered a stupid, idiotic thing, because that is all they have been habituated to. This kind of situation would not have arisen if, like all other creatures, human beings knew when and how to die gracefully. So for people who do not have the capacity to set the body at will, what can they do to exit it gracefully? How and when do you make that call? It is not the same for everyone. One person may be very strong at age 85. Another may have to live at 70. It depends on many factors. Chronological age is not the criteria. To know this with some certainty, one needs a certain amount of sadhana or insight into life. Then you will know when infirmity is coming. You will know when your body is becoming unstable, and you will feel you have completed your karma. Otherwise, you feel lost in this world, which unfortunately is the state of most modern people. In ancient times, there was a lot of community support for people to consciously take this step of running the body down and living gracefully. When the time came, in the Jain community, for example, they had a practice called Sallekhana or Santara. The Hindus have something similar like Prayopravesa. In this tradition, when someone felt they had approached the stage of living, if they were so conscious they could decide for themselves, it was perfectly acceptable. If someone was not aware, Then they consulted all the people around, including the family, the elders of the community, and their spiritual head. People then discussed and debated this. Let us say someone gives you an application saying, I think it is time for me to do Sallekhana or Prayopavesha. So they would debate, discuss and say, no, this is not the time for you. Why do you want to do this? They would list out all the things that were yet to happen in the person's life and all the responsibilities that he or she had to fulfill. But the person says, no, no, I think I have done enough of that. My body is not letting me stay. I need to go. Then they would say, we have to consult so and so, who is considered to be a spiritual head of the community. They would consult him together and decide, okay, I think it is time for this person to go. Maybe not now, but next year. So he or she would decide to go the following year based on the society's advice. They would then be formally initiated into a process by the spiritual head. The process itself could be long drawn and in many stages. At each stage, the spiritual head would review the progress and make sure that this was really the right thing for this person. If there was the slightest doubt about it, it would be called off and the person would be taken off it. Let us say, this was about me. Maybe I will say, okay, in another 6 months, I want to leave. So I may consult people at the yoga center. I think I have done enough. You are taking care of the yoga center wonderfully. I don't think Devi needs me or the Dhyanalinga needs me or anyone needs me. I think it is time for me to go in a year's time. They say, no, no, Sadhguru, you must be here. I say, okay, how long? They say, Sadhguru, another 20 years. I say, no, no, max 3 years. If everyone is mature or conscious enough, we can talk about this and arrive at something. Otherwise, you just utter the word death, all hell will break loose. When the entire society is conscious that death is an inevitable part of our life, we can sit down, negotiate, guide each other, arrive at something and decide that this is the best way to do it. This is just like fixing an arranged marriage in India. Let us say your daughter has come of age, so when to get her married? The family sits down and discusses and debates about it. They ask the girl her views. They listen to what she has to say, look at the overall situation and see what is best and finally arrive at a date, isn't it? Similarly, death is also another part of your life. You should handle it so. In the past, this was very widely practiced, though in many different forms. Even kings chose to take to Vanaprastha Ashrama and Sallekhana or Prayopavesha towards the end of their lives. One of the most famous people who took Sallekhana was Chandragupta Maurya. Chandragupta Maurya was the founder of the Mauryan Empire and the first emperor to unify India into one nation. No other emperor since has managed to create a bigger empire in the subcontinent. He ruled for 322 BC to 298 BC. Ashoka was his grandson. When he was 42 years old, Chandragupta abdicated his throne in favor of his son Bindusara. He then became an ascetic under the Jain saint Bhadrabahu and migrated to southern India along with the Jain monks. At the age of 55, he ended his life through Sallekhana at Sravana Belagola in Karnataka. Even today, the small stone enclosure where he lived after taking Sallekhana can be seen in Sravana Belagola. In modern times, many eminent public figures like Acharya, Vinoba, Bhave, choose this form of death. So just as you make efforts to live, you should also make efforts to prepare to die. You should decide, in case I die, I want to die like this. Right now, let us say, I am going to die tomorrow. I am not planning to die tomorrow. But if it comes, am I ready? 100%. Because all my life, I prepared for it. Does that mean I am seeking to die tomorrow? No. I will do everything to see that I live well. I always say, in life, one should have passion towards the highest, compassion for all, and dispassion towards oneself. Similarly, I would say, if you want to die well, you have to cultivate a certain amount of dispassion towards your own death. Otherwise, one will go struggling, kicking, and screaming, which will not be good for what is going to come next.